Welcome back. In this episode, we're going to be talking about strings. And this is really where we're going to be spending a lot of our focus in this class, because this contains language data, and most of the data that I'm interested in, as somebody who works on literature, is language data. So if you want to create a string in Python, all you need to use are either double or single quotes, like I mentioned last time. So for example, I can have my string equals double quotation marks, hello, how are you today, close quotation marks, or I can use single quotation marks, as in line 3 here. Now sometimes you'll find yourself wanting to include an apostrophe inside of a string, and so here, if you want to do that, you have a few options. The first thing is you can just use double quotation marks, so then inside your quotation marks, inside the string, you can use this single apostrophe. You can also use a backslash to escape that apostrophe, so Python doesn't treat that apostrophe as if it's part of your code. It just treats it as what is known as a string literal. Now, I should finish this by pointing out that you cannot close a string using a different quote type than you started it with. This is just going to cause an error. So for example, on line 15, if you tried to run this code yourself already, you'll find this will give you an error. Test string 3 equals hello. So if I go over to the terminal and try to run this, we'll find that it's going to give us an error. And here you can see it tells me on line 15 there's this syntax error, end of line when scanning string literal. So if I go back over here, we can take a look at this. We just fix this, make it a double quotation mark, save it, try to run it again. It runs, no problem. Now notice, there was no output because I didn't print anything out. There are a lot of methods that strings come with that are very useful for us as people who are interested in language data. If we go and look at the next file, we can see that these strings come with a very interesting method called count. So if I create a string called myString, what I can do is I can count how many of any type of substring appear in that string. So here, I'm creating a variable that I'm calling afreak equals mystring.count, and inside parentheses, I'm typing the string a. And then I'm just going to print out whatever the result is. Now alternatively, I can save this count term as a variable and stick that inside the parentheses, where mystring.count, and inside the parentheses I put count term, and I can print afrequency. If I run this, what we can see is the output is going to be exactly the same. It's 2 both times, because A appears in that string twice. Now often, I might want to add strings together. So for example, if I have 2 strings, my string equals hello friend, and a second string that equals hello, how are you, I can add them together to form a new string. So new string equals my string and a plus sign, and then the second string. And if I print out this new string, what we can see is our new string like this. Hello, friend. How are you? Now notice, there is no space between these two, because when I'm adding these together, Python doesn't understand that I'm using English, and that the convention is there should be a space, one space, after the punctuation mark. So if I go back and I want to make sure there is a space, I can go over to the next file, and all I've done is I have changed it just very slightly, where new string equals my string plus, and then just a space in between 2 quotation marks. Now notice that this might look blank, but it's not, because a space is a valid character in a string. When I run this, we can see, and I'm just going to hit the up button and change that. Hello, friend. How are you? And now we have the space. So remember that Python's actually really dumb. It's only going to do exactly what you tell it to do, and you're going to need to give it that extra space. So a very common thing that we might want to do is add strings together. And this is a process that's known as string concatenation. So in order to do it, we just need to use the plus sign. I have 2 strings here. My string equals hello friend. Second string equals how are you? And I'm just going to add them together. New string equals my string plus second string. And I'm just going to print out the results of that. So if I go over to my terminal, I'll just type in the name of this file, which is 03 strings 2. I think it's strings 3, concatenate1.py. If I hit enter, you can see that now I have hello friend, how are you? But notice, Python is actually pretty dumb. It doesn't know that there should be a space, one space, after that exclamation point. It just treated whatever we gave it extremely literally. So if we want to make sure that this actually looks good, we need to tell it that that space should be there. So if we look at the next piece of code, concat2, what we can see is that in order to do this, I have the exact same code, except it's my string plus quotation mark space, close quotation mark, plus second string. Now, I should point out that this might look like a blank string, but that character, the space character, is a valid string. So be aware of that. So when I run this, all I need to do is change the file name and say, hello, friend, space, how are you? So now it works just fine. Now, there are other things we can do with concatenation. For example, what happens if we have strings that are also numbers? So number 1 equals 1, 2, 3, 4 inside quotation marks, and number 2 equals 5, 6, 7, 8. Here, I have new num equals num1 plus num2. What do you expect might happen? Well, is the answer going to be these two numbers added together? No, it's not. It's going to be these strings added together. And that just looks like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So you have to pay attention to what types of variables you're using depending on what sort of behavior you actually want. Now, in many cases, when we are working with language information, we'll want to measure different things about our strings. And the first thing we might want to do is check, well, how long is this string? Well, here I have a string, hello, my name is Paul. To check the length, I use the len function. So len, open parentheses, and then inside the parentheses, I put in a string, and then close parentheses. So here I could have typed this string inside the parentheses directly. And this will just return an integer that is however long this string is, or however many characters are contained within this string. So I can print string length, or alternatively, I can actually call the length function inside the print function. It'll still evaluate exactly how you would expect. So when I run this, I'll go ahead and change this. And we can see that we get 23 both times. That's exactly what we want. Now, many times, we actually want to change the strings over the course of the code that we're running. And we'll see this when we want to edit things out that we don't think should be there as part of our analysis, or if we just want to find a shorter part of a longer string. And you can use what are known as string indices to get these. So we have this same string, hello, my name is Paul, and we can look for specific items in that string based on where they are. Now, I should point out that indexes for strings, as well as all other Python objects, start at 0. So Python is a 0-indexed language. Now, other computer programming languages like R are 1-indexed. Many of them are 0-indexed, though, like Python. So if we want the very first character in this string, what we need to do is we need to take our variable name, myString, and then square brackets, 0, close square brackets. So here, we're just printing the very first character, which is an h. To print the last character, we can actually give it negative 1. That just says, go to the end and find the very first character that shows up at the end. Negative 4 would be 4 back. So to print the first 10 characters, what you can do is you can type open bracket, and then a colon, and then 10, and then a close colon. Now, note that this will print all the characters at indexes 0 to 9. It actually doesn't print whatever character is at that 10th index. This is really useful because in that second number, in that second number, we can put in essentially the length there. So this will just give us the first 10 characters. If we want the characters from indexes 4 to 12, we'll put the beginning index before that colon and the ending index after it, the ending index plus 1. So here, 4 colon 13 will give us characters 4 to 12. If we want everything from a particular index on to the very end of the string, we can do 8 colon nothing. Okay? When I run this, it's just going to print out all of these different substrings. You can see it's H, exclamation point, hello, comma, my, oh, my nam, and I name is Paul. Okay? So essentially, we've just broken this string down into smaller parts. There are other things we can do with these substrings. For example, we can actually change the original string itself if we save it back into the same variable. This will be really useful if we want to clean up a text. So, hello, my name is Paul. What I can do is I can say my string equals my string square bracket colon 15 close square bracket. This looks a little weird, but it's essentially evaluating what this will be here and then saving it back into my string. So here, first I'll print the unchanged string, and then I'll print the changed string. So if I run this, we can see that hello, my name is Paul, then becomes hello, my name. Okay? This will be a very useful thing. This variable replacement will happen a lot in the code we'll see. Now, Python does have basic find methods. So if we want to find where in a string does a particular substring occur, you can use the .find method. So here I have hello, my name is Paul as a string. And I'm just going to say my string .find name and save it as a result. So this will give me the index of where this string name starts. Okay? Now I should point out this will only find the first instance of this substring. It won't find any others. So be aware of that as you're running your code or writing your code. So I should also say that if the substring that you are searching for isn't in the string, it'll return a negative one. So this is an important thing to remember. I'll go ahead and run this. Strings 6, find 1. Go ahead and run that. And you can see that name starts at 10, and how gets a negative 1 because it's not actually in this particular string. We can look at more uses of this find function by using the find function to break a string apart. So we can actually insert the results of our find inside that substring. So my string, square bracket, my string dot find name, colon. And here I'm just saving it to some variable that I'm calling partial string. What this will do is it'll just evaluate to name, in this case it's 10, so it's just like saying 10 colon, but it's useful if we don't know where that name actually is occurring. So if I run this, we can see, that is 7. That's a mistake. You can see it just says, name is Paul. So this is a really useful thing to do if, for instance, you're working with a Project Gutenberg file and you don't want a lot of the boilerplate at the beginning to influence the analysis that you're doing. Often, you also want to do other things to clean up your text, and you can do this with the replace method. So, for example, if I want to replace all the A's in a string with O's, I can use dot replace, open parentheses, A, that's what do I want to replace, and O, what do I want to replace it with? And I'll save this as AO mixup variable. You can also print replace multiple characters at once. So you can say auto equals my string dot replace AU comma OO. You can also save it to the same variable. And this is a useful thing to do in the cases where you're cleaning a text and you're making a lot of changes to it. So here, if I say my string dot replace AO equals my string, it'll just actually change that original string. So here, Python 03, strings 8. We run it, and we can see here are the results of all of these changes. Hello, my nom is Paul. Hello, my name is Paul. Hello, my name is Paul. And hello, my nom is Paul. So you can see this is a kind of a fun way of changing strings around. The last thing I want to talk about as it relates to strings right now are the various methods that come with strings. I've covered a few of them, and I want to cover just quickly a few other useful ones, but not all of them, because there are a lot of them. You can there are a lot of methods to find out information about a particular string. So you can actually check on its value. Here I have a string that's called 7. I can say, is it alphanumeric, using my numstring.isAlNum. I can check, is it a decimal number, by using isDecimal. I can check if it's just numeric at all, by isNumeric. And is it alphabetical, with isAlpha. Now these will return Booleans, so true or false. You can also capitalize a sentence. So if I have this is lowercase with a lowercase t at the beginning, you can actually use dot capitalize to raise that t. You can also make something completely lowercase. So shout equals this sure seems like shouting, and print shout.lower will actually make all of this lowercase. You can also make everything uppercase by saying not shout equals this didn't start as a shout, and printing shout.upper. Okay? I'll go ahead and run this really quick, and we can see what that looks like. So here we can see true, true, false. That's fine. That just returned Booleans describing the 7 string. Then this is lowercase. This sure seems like shouting in lowercase, and this sure seems like shouting in uppercase. So what you can see is that actually, this is interesting because there's a small mistake in this code here. If we see that I have said shout.upper, this actually should have been not shout.upper. I'll save that, and I'll go ahead and rerun it, and you can see this didn't start as a shout, and now we fixed it. So that's a really quick introduction to string methods. We're going to be seeing a lot of those as we build interesting programs to do our analysis. In the next episode, I'm going to talk a little bit about math and about casting types. That's changing one data type into a different type. So I'll see you next time, and I hope you're enjoying it so far. Thank you.